makes not one but two errors, and then a foul pop down the left field line turns into a sacrifice fly. The ball is caught by Jack Hanahan, but Torres races home with what would be the winning run. Now, yesterday, Justin Masterson pitched very well for the Indians, did not give up an earned run through 6 2/3. Matt Cain pitched just as well, maybe a little bit better for the Giants. 7 shutout innings, the only run of the game came at the bottom of the 7th on, of all things, a balk by Tony Sipp. 1-0, the Giants win. They have won the first 2 games of the series. Joined as always by Bobby Valentine and Oral Hershiser. Oral, let's start with you. Take us into the pitcher's mind. Madison Bumgarner, 9 hits, 8 runs in a third of an inning on Tuesday. How do you bounce back here tonight?
Yeah, young man made the big leagues when he's 20 years old. He's now 21. He's going into his 35th start. I think he will respond, but he has to respond from a devastating outing, as you said, Dan. The fastball was up. It was in the middle of the plate. He only threw 25 pitches, and there's not any room really to make an adjustment. He didn't walk anybody. It was just hit. Single, double, single, double, single, double. Go all the way up the 9th. Hasn't happened since the 1900s against any pitcher recording 1 out, 9 hits. But you know what? The young man has a lot of character, has a lot of stuff. He was 7-6 coming into this year with a 2.9 ERA. The Giants have not supported him with run support this year. He needs to get their help as much as his own.
They feel he's a special young talent, and the Cleveland Indians feel they have a special young talent as well, Bobby, in shortstop Asdrubal Cabrera.
Absolutely. This is a switch-hitting 25-year-old kid who is exciting the fans of Cleveland and of all of baseball. He's a highlight film, a web gem waiting to happen. He's very creative, he's very confident, and he's very, very electric in all the things he does by underhanding the ball, throwing it behind his back, and playing with extreme fun and confidence, barehanding a ball here, throwing it across the diamond. He leads the team in home runs, RBIs, on his way to the All-Star game and to a great career.
The Indians are looking for somebody to help Cabrera out offensively. No Chu, he's injured. No Hafner, he's the DH, so the best they can hope for is for him to pinch hit. Maybe Grady Sizemore is the guy. He's with Buster Olney.
Grady, a long road back from knee surgery for you. What's been the biggest adjustment?
Just trusting the knee. I think first couple of weeks back, it just didn't feel right. You know, I still had some pain and some soreness. So, you know, working through that and getting the new feel.
Now, I saw you guys looking at videotape of Madison Bumgarner who's starting against you tonight. What did you learn?
Well, just that we have to, you know, get the ball out of the plate. You know, make him throw strikes, get our pitch. He's got a tough delivery, a little funky. It's going to be tough to pick up. So we're going to have to work it early and, work to see the ball and get the ball up.
Grady, thanks. Dan, back to you.
Buster, thank you. Tonight, as we watch this game between the Indians and the Giants, we'll revisit the 1954 World Series between these two organizations. Also, a look around the majors with the BBTN gang, including a close-up look at some of the Indians' competitors in the American League Central. Also, some of the lesser-known closers who are having big seasons for their team. Should be fun. Beautiful night, beautiful ballpark. The Giants are going for the sweep. Left-hander Madison Bumgarner on the mound for San Francisco against the Tribe when we come back. NFL Showdown, presented by State Farm.
Boy, do they have bridges here. The Golden Gate, the Bay Bridge, and more. Mighty spans linking the great communities of Northern California. But you could think, too, that the San Francisco Giants are the greatest bridge around. Linking baseball history that goes across the country, across the decades. They span societies, races, linking people to the great game. And they promise to carry forward to uncharted prospects and success in the future, too.
The Golden Gate Bridge, one of the landmarks. Now the Bay Bridge, just such a gorgeous view. Depending on where you're sitting in this ballpark, you can see the bridges across the bay, across to the East Bay. Postcard, picture perfect here at AT&T Park in San Francisco as the Giants host the Indians here on Sunday Night Baseball. The exchange of the lineup cards at home plate. Hunter Wendelstedt, the home plate umpire, along with the crew chief Jerry Lane, the second base umpire, taking charge of the proceedings as the Indians and Giants get set to wrap up a three-game series. A couple of one-run wins for the San Francisco Giants over the Indians so far this weekend. So Manny Acta's team will be looking to avoid a sweep here tonight. And here it is on Friday. This looks like a harmless pop-up in foul territory, but with a runner at third and a tough play and a little hesitation, Andres Torres scores the eventual winning run. And then Tony Sipp with a balk. Not an obvious one, but a balk, scoring the only run of the game yesterday as the Indians lose 1-0. The Indians are 40-35. They're a half game back of the Tigers for top spot in the American League Central. Detroit beat Arizona today. Manny Acta's team needs to start swinging the bat a little bit better than they have been in recent weeks. Let's take a look at the Indians starting lineup now, brought to you by Taco Bell. Michael Brantley will lead it off into left field, and a couple of Cabreras, no relation between Orlando, who's at second base, and as Drubal, the shortstop. Carlos Santana is at first base tonight, batting cleanup. Grady Sizemore down to the five spot the last couple of days. More on that later. Shelly Duncan, recently recalled from the minors, is in right field, batting sixth. Lou Marson, who's got a great arm, catching and hitting seventh. The veteran Adam Everett at third base, batting eighth, and the struggling Fausto Carmona is on the mound and batting ninth. 21 years young, but apparently poised and mature well beyond his years. That may come in handy tonight for Madison Bumgarner.
The young man coming off one of the roughest outings that anyone could ever come off of. One third of an inning, nine hits. That was the shortest outing by any major league pitcher since 1900, and he needs some run support from his teammates. Also, over the last nine games, they've only hit 113 with runs in scoring position. This young man, though, will throw strikes. He will respond with character. He has a fastball. He's going to face seven right-handed hitters in the lineup for the Indians, and he's going to cut that fastball in under their hands as his out pitch, and he also has a nice curveball to them also.
To show you how the Giants feel about Bumgarner, a lot of people would treat him with kid gloves after that kind of an outing on Tuesday, but they said to him, his teammates said to him, hey, we're going to make sure we get to the bullpen or to the dugout early. We want to see you pitch tonight. So we better get there early just in case. So they're poking fun at him, and he, by all accounts, can take a joke. And the Giants are not worried about him. Let's check out the defense behind Bumgarner tonight with Cody Ross at left, Andres Torres in center, Nate Schierholz in right. On the left side of the infield, it's Pablo Sandoval, and then rookie Brandon Crawford is back in the lineup at shortstop. Bill Hall at second base tonight. Aubrey Huff is at first. And Chris Stewart, who throws very well, is the catcher for Bumgarner tonight. Bobby, you want to focus on the man out in center field, Mr. Torres.
Yeah, Torres is a guy who has to make things happen offensively and defensively for this Giant team. He's dealing with a little ADD problem. It's the documentary going to be made about him, but he's now got his whole game in order, ready to play. This was just yesterday.
Deep fly ball, battling the sun, tumbling backwards on the edge of the track, but it makes the catch. That was the final out of the win yesterday. And as you can see, wasn't even looking at the ball or at his glove when the ball went into his glove.
By that time, you've judged where it's going to be, and he said, well, if I'm wrong, I don't want to hit me in the face. But he was right.
Ready to go here in San Francisco. Bumgarner on the mound. Brantley, the leadoff hitter for the Indians. We're set for Sunday Night Baseball.
Ball one.
And Hunter Wendelstedt calling the pitch inside for ball one. Brian Knight, Jerry Lane, Bob Davidson, the other umpires tonight. Brantley hitting 280 on the season. He's got some speed. Had three hits in yesterday's game. The Indians, as we mentioned, are without Travis Hafner, their DH. This game being played in a National League park. All he can do is pinch hit. They are without the injured Shin-Soo Chu, who suffered a broken thumb hit by a pitch on Friday by Giants pitcher Jonathan Sanchez. Chu out at least 6 weeks. So the Indians, who were a great hitting ball club back in April, are not a great hitting ball club right now. Not that the Giants are going to have any sympathy for them in that regard. In the dirt, 2-2. And Cleveland actually fired their hitting coach a few weeks back, John Nunnally, when they were right in the midst of a deep team-wide hitting slump. Brought in their organizational hitting instructor, Bruce Fields, to take over. And Fields alongside other members of the staff in the dugout. Fields has worked with a number of these hitters in the minors. Close but no, full count.
You know, Dan, they hit so well early in the season, hitting in the clutch, getting big hits when needed. When that stopped happening, they fired the hitting coach. I'm not so sure that's the way to do things.
3-2, line to right field, and caught by Shearholz racing over into the alley.
Madison Bumgarner, as he watched that ball go out to right field as a line drive, he was pulling really hard for that to be caught. When you go a third of an inning and give up nine hits, and then this in a 3-2 count to the first batter, becomes a line drive to right field, a nice left-on-left swing. But as far as analyzing the pitcher's heart, right here, it started beating again.
So the first out of the game is recorded. Now Orlando Cabrera takes outside ball one. Cabrera, through most of his career a shortstop, has played mostly second base for the Indians, where he is tonight, but they're also moving him at times to third base, where he has never played prior to the last week. But in an effort to get more offense, they called up a young man by the name of Cord Phelps, a left-handed batter, to play second base against righties. So a lot of times Cabrera moves to third, and he has accepted the assignment. Then again, as the manager beside me would say, well, of course he's accepted the assignment.
He accepted it, but talking to him before the game, he's not comfortable at third base. He feels middle and infield is where he belongs. He's at second base tonight. Hopefully he'll contribute.
Anthony's for a strike, 2-2. I'll tell you this, Hunter Wendelstedt brought the pipes tonight. He brought his A game calling those strikes behind the plate. Pops him up. Bill Hall makes the catch, two down. As you watch tonight, you can also follow Buster Olney and Wendy Nix on Twitter, but also like us on Facebook at facebook.com/ESPN Baseball Tonight. Just another great view. So many beautiful shots and camera angles that we are lucky to bring to you here tonight at AT&T Park, where once again, as was the case 2 weeks ago, before long, the shadows will become a major factor in this game. As Drubal Cabrera is the batter. As Bobby mentioned off the top of the show, in all likelihood headed to the All-Star game, leads the team in a number of offensive categories,
including 12 for 12 in stolen bases.
Mm-hmm. For those of you who are regular Baseball Tonight watchers, he leads the majors in web gems, and about half of them are of the barehanded variety.
He's really creative in the field. He does things that haven't been done before. He has practiced them, I believe. Barry Larkin was saying before the game that he's so nonchalant with his behind the back throw.
And a strike, 3-1, as is the case with many players from Venezuela, as Drubal Cabrera wears number 13 in honor of Omar Vizquel, who wore it in honor of Davy Concepcion. Foul to back, full count. Cabrera, 25 years of age, from Puerto La Cruz, Venezuela. two pretty good role models in Vizquel and Concepcion for a young shortstop.
I played against Davey Concepcion and with Omar Vizquel. Say Omar is still the best fielder, but this guy's creeping up on him.
Into right field. That's a base hit.
I think he has a ways to go to catch up with Omar, really, but he does have a flair about him, himself in the field, and he does things that really Omar hasn't done, nor did Davey. They're really, he's a very creative defensive player.
There's a guy they think has a chance to be a pretty special offensive player, Carlos Santana. He's got some power. He's a switch hitter. Another one of the young players the Indians picked up in a trade in recent years. When they traded all those veterans away as they went through a rebuilding project, they got a lot of quality, young, talented, quality players back. This is one of them.
And remember, he was injured last year in what many people thought was a very career threatening injury in a collision with his leg. He's come back 100%. And I think his balance now is very good at the plate, ready to drive the ball.
Swinging a ground ball down to third, and the inning is over. No runs, a base hit, and a man left on. Madison Bumgarner, a much better first inning for him than five nights ago. We'll see if Fausto Carmona has his A game when we come back.
And Sunday Night Baseball is presented by Taco Bell. Think outside the bun. And in part by State Farm. For auto, home, life, and banking, get to a better state. And by Lowe's. Lowe's. Let's build something together. No scores. We go to the bottom of the first. A look at the South Beach Yacht Club adjacent here to AT&T Park. A look at the starting lineup now for the Giants, brought to you by Taco Bell, the worst offensive team in baseball this season. Andres Torres, rookie Brandon Crawford, and the Panda, Pablo Sandoval, batting third. Aubrey Huff, Cody Ross playing left, batting fifth. Nate Schierholz in right field, batting sixth. Bill Hall gets the start at second base, batting seventh. Chris Stewart behind the plate. Of course, Buster Posey out for the year. And Madison Bumgarner pitching and batting ninth. In on the corners as Andres Torres steps in to lead it off for the Giants. Torres had three hits on Friday, including a bunt single. He is a threat. He had really been struggling until breaking out with three hits, including a home run on Friday night against the Indians. You talked about the ADD from which Torres suffers, and Bruce Bochy was telling us before the game that he was having trouble sleeping and focusing, and he just wasn't right. So they gave him a couple of days, Wednesday and Thursday, to not play, be out of the lineup. And he came back rejuvenated, much more in control Friday. Pulls the ground ball to second. One down. Well, Oral, is there any pitcher in a baseball who confounds people as much as Fausto Carmona?
19-game winner back in 2007. He was the opening day starter, and now he's almost battling for his job. That highest in the American League ERA at 5.98. And that stems from the fact that with nobody on, hitters are hitting 218. With people on base, 359. We're really going to need to look at his mechanics from the windup and the stretch tonight.
He starts Brandon Crawford with a strike. Crawford, the young shortstop, was down at A ball recovering from an injury when the Giants summoned him to the big leagues earlier this season. Got off to a very good start with the bat, but has been a little overmatched recently offensively. Tapper back to the mound. Just like that, two down.
Fausto Carmona gets more ground balls than anybody, and you watch this two-seam fastball. It just falls off the table. He shatters this bat at 94 miles an hour to get that kind of movement and that location. The ball moved from the sweet spot of the bat to the end of the bat and shattered it.
Back in 2007, a sensational season for Carmona. Won 19 games, had the second best ERA in the American League. There's a liner to first off the bat of Pablo Sandoval, and very quickly, just six pitches needed as Carmona gets the Giants in order. The Giants and the Indians, Sunday Night Baseball from AT&T Park in San Francisco. No score, top of the second. And a strike taken by Grady Sizemore, the center fielder for the Indians. A guy who the last couple of years has battled injury after injury, including microfracture surgery on his left knee last year. Ooh, runs it right off the mask of Chris Stewart, the catcher. And the home plate umpire, Hunter Wentelstedt, as well. Went on the right cheek, he's saying, but he appears to be all right.
Grady really has a left foot lead here on this bunt. Goes across the line and behind home plate. He sets his angle, just doesn't center the ball properly. He had Pablo send the ball back. He laid it down. Would have been a hit.
0-2 breaking ball down and away to Sizemore. Sizemore also with a bruised right knee earlier this year, spent some time on the DL, was hitting over 300 before he got hurt, under 200 since he's come back. And Bobby, what makes him so important, again, without Hafner and Chu, not to belabor the point, But Manny Acta actually dropped Sizemore into more of an RBI spot in the batting order because they need somebody to drive in some runs.
Yeah, to get a left-handed hitter down there, a guy who has produced in the past. A lot of people thought he was not a leadoff hitter. It should be batting in the middle of the lineup.
Sounds like he broke his bat on that one. As he stays alive at 1-2 and heads back toward the dugout for a new one. At the beginning of the season, it was kind of the Brady Sizemore of 2007 and 2008, who was one of the great young talents in baseball. Though Sizemore is not stealing bases, the knee problems evidently keeping him from running the bases freely. But since he's come back, just 177 in 26 games, one of the big reasons why the Indians are scuffling.
Microsurgery on his left knee, and then had trouble with his right knee earlier this season, put him on the disabled list. Very difficult to play this game without a good foundation, and your legs are your foundation.
Waits on the breaking ball, and he sends it into right field, a fair ball. And Sizemore is on his way to second, in there with a leadoff double.
A breaking ball that just kind of hangs up there and says, hit me. Your eyes start to light up if you're a hitter, and it's right there at his hip, but he sees the spin and stays in there and makes a really good swing at it. He doesn't kill the ball. He hits it in the right place, gets himself a little humpback liner double.
And of all people in the lineup, Duncan's not someone who handles the bat well. He's a swinger when he's up there, and he falls that one off his foot, Dan. And you really want to get this run across. You want to get have the Giants be behind early in the game because they score so few runs. It makes it so much tougher for them to come back. Get them over some way, Shelly Duncan. Hit the ball to the right side. Drive it in the right center.
Just recalled for the minors a couple of days ago when Chu suffered the broken thumb. Duncan and figures to get some playing time in the outfield. Austin Kearns, Travis Buck. Manny Acta will rotate those guys in there. One thing the Indians, one of the big reasons why they got off to such a good start, 30-15 on the season, in these kinds of situations, runners in scoring position, they were the best in baseball at coming up with the base hits. Since May 23rd, they are the worst in baseball.
It's just a progression towards the mean. You know, no way you're going to stay that hot with runners in scoring position, especially when you're hitting singles to drive those runs in and not home runs. A lot of times those singles just become outs because they're placed at the shortstop rather than in the hole, or at the pitcher rather than up the middle.
As you said earlier this year, never evaluate a team when they're playing at their absolute best, and never evaluate them when they're playing at their absolute worst. And the Indians have seen both ends of it. And Duncan can't move him.
Well, sometimes you get a hitter out, and sometimes he gets himself out. Madison Bumgarner, little breaking ball here, and he slows him down, and then he goes with a high hard one after slowing him down and just beats him to the spot. He didn't beat him velocity wise. He just beat him to the spot. The low and away breaking ball slowed down the reaction time, and then the up fastball got him.
So now the catcher, Lou Marson. Marson getting a lot of playing time recently, again, because of another injury to a certain extent. Matt LaPorta, the first baseman, is out. Carlos Santana getting more time than he normally does at first base. So Marson taking advantage of the extra opportunities behind the plate. They like his defense. They love his throwing. They're hoping the bat is going to come around. He's hitting 229.
The better your defense, the more patient they can be waiting for the bat. But if you can't play defense, especially at the position of catcher.
Yeah, in this situation with Marson, if they've watched the prior game films, they know that he can't drive the ball over the right fielder's head. Thurl should be in about five steps from where he is. The center fielder is more shallow than the right fielder this time.
Runner is going. Pitch down and in, throw down, and out at third base is Sizemore. Arguing the call, but Chris Stewart throws him out.
That's a very big leg kick. A good jump by Sizemore, a strong throw to third. I thought he was safe. Here's the kick, decent jump. The throw there, Sandoval kind of sweeps the tag, looks like he might hit him on the knee.
Did he get a piece of him with that swipe tag? The chopper over the mound, second baseman Hall, got it. The inning is over. Sizemore thrown out to the bottom of the second. No score. Town Oral Hershiser, Sunday Night Baseball on ESPN. And as you saw about an inning ago, home plate umpire Hunter Wendelstedt was hit in the mask on the right side of his face on a bunt attempt by Grady Sizemore. Let's show you the play again. And that happened when Sizemore was the batter to begin the bottom of the second. Hunter Wendelstedt finished the half inning, but in between innings came got a little medical attention and is unable to continue. So obviously got his bell rung quite severely, and he is not going to be able to stay in this game. And Jerry Lane, the crew chief, a couple of minutes ago went inside to get the extra gear on, the chest protector and so forth, and he evidently, Bobby, is going to take over as the home plate umpire.
Yeah, and I think they'll work this game with three umpires, and right now Bruce Bochy's talking with the two of the umpires, trying to figure out how they're going to rotate, what this is all going to mean to the game. And what it's really meaning is that these shadows are creeping in. So as soon as the Giants get out there, they're going to start playing with the benefit of the shadows, and Madison will be able to get a few quick outs.
Are there real complications, guys, when you've only got three umpires out there?
Oh, they just rotate a little bit differently. They'll have different responsibilities, and depending on the situation, we can't sit up here and explain them because it depends on man of first and second, what it could be. But you know, you hope Hunter's feeling better. And he comes from an umpiring family. Harry Windelstad, his dad, was an umpire during our time. And, you know, Hunter's a very good umpire.
Yep.
Very good guy, very good umpire. And the challenge is for the three umpires in this ballpark is that right field, that so many things can happen out there, whether it's out or it's in, how it's being played and kicked around. And that's going to be a challenge as they're running around this ballpark.
So the delay will continue until Jerry Lane is able to get back out there with the equipment on and assume his duties behind home plate. Fausto Carmona, who is, as we told you, maybe pitching for his spot in the rotation right now for the Indians, and came in here with horrible numbers, especially recently. He looked very good in the bottom of the first, three up and three down, a couple of ground outs, and a lineout. Maybe the last thing that he wants, obviously the health of Hunter Wendelstedt is first and foremost here, but the last thing that Fausto Carmona wants, Oral, is just to sit there and cool off when he finally got a good inning under his belt.
Yeah, he's already come out of the dugout and threw a couple of warm-up pitches while the medical staff was looking at Hunter, but then they asked him, Bob Davidson said, you know, why don't you come in and sit down? We'll give you your regular routine. You'll get as many as you want when you get back out there when we're ready to go. So he had very good rhythm, was locating the ball, and was on a roll. Hopefully he'll be able to keep those positive thoughts for the Indians.
The other two umpires, Bob Davidson and Brian Knight, waiting for Jerry Lane to come back out. The third and final game of the series between the Indians and the Giants. The Giants winning the first two both by one run, dropping the Indians out of first place in the American League Central. The Tigers won again today, beat Arizona 8-3. So the Tigers are now in first place, just ahead of Cleveland, a division that Cleveland has led most of the season. But right now the Tigers are a half game up. The White Sox 4.5 out. Minnesota, which had been playing very well, suffered a couple of injuries this week. Adelman Young back on the DL. Justin Amore, no. Now we know that he will undergo neck surgery, so they have fallen on hard times and have lost five in a row. And here's Jerry Lane. Got the gear on, and he'll move from second to base behind the plate, and they'll go with three umpires.
It's an amazing game we play here and watch here and talk about here, Dan. You know, Shelly Duncan could not move the runner over from second to third with no outs. Consequently, Sizemore tries to steal third, tries to make something happen. He knows he has to be on third base with one out. He knows his team hasn't been scoring, and to get a lead on the Giants would be so important. He makes the attempt. He gets thrown out, and here's Carmona out there without a run to his side, and it could be a very big run in this game.
So now Fausto Carmona will get to take his warm-up pitches, and Jerry Lane will get to call his warm-up pitches to get acclimated behind the plate. It looks like Brian Knight is over at first base. Bob Davidson for the moment is still at third base. We'll go with three umps tonight as the shadows, as you can continue to see, creeping closer and closer to the field of play. We were here 2 weeks ago, and guys, the shadows became one of the dominant stories in that game between the Reds and Giants when we were here a couple of weeks ago.
Well, as soon as the shadows creep in, it's very hard for the hitters to see, not only to see the ball, but to see the same kind of things that they would see in the light, with the seams rotating, the release point of the pitcher. And as Bobby explained, it's really not about like where the ball is. It's about how the changes in light, your eye can't adjust to that.
Well, the Giants get one crack here, seeing it in natural light, and then the shadows will be there next time they come up. We'll have about three, four innings of play where the shadows will come into play. So they have to take advantage, just like the Indians did not take advantage last inning.
Aubrey Huff will lead off the bottom of the second for the Giants. The first baseman hitting 244. Huff is the club leader in RBIs with 38. Nobody else on the team even has 25. And the Giants are four games away from the midway point of the regular season. Good off-speed pitch there from Carmona.
That was a nasty changeup.
Has a fabulous arm. It's all about command and control. Well, the ball moves a lot.
Yeah. The delay doesn't seem to affect him. Right out 2.
That's the first ball that he's thrown tonight. Just the ninth pitch. He only needed 6 pitches to retire the side in the first inning. He was an all-star last year, won 13 games, had a respectable ERA of 3.77. But this year, an ERA of almost 6. And Huff chases a running fastball off the outside corner for out number 1.
Went fastball, changeup, changeup, fastball. Well, here we are with the changeup that he backs up after the one that he had just thrown in that area, but a little higher. And then that fastball right there just had a tremendous amount of tail.
If he was a hitter, you would say he steps in the bucket when he throws. He really opens up his bottom side, and he's so strong he's able to get on that first base side of the ball as he propels it forward. He gets extreme movement moving into the right-hander away from the left-hander.
The batter is Cody Ross, the left fielder, hitting 261. Ross, the guy who came over to the Giants late last season and just electrified this city with his performance in the postseason, specifically in the NLCS when he was named the MVP. Yanks it to left field. That's a base hit. Now, one of the biggest problems that Fausto Carmona has had this year is when men have been on base. Actually, a drastic difference in the numbers when he pitches with nobody on base versus when there is somebody on base. A 359 average roll. What do you think's going on?
Probably a little difference in his mechanics, maybe a little anxiety that he doesn't pitch to contact as much all of a sudden when there's people on base. He is a big fella, and maybe his timing gets thrown off by trying to go quickly to home. It'll be interesting to watch this transformation from wind up to stretch.
Nate Shearholtz, the right fielder. Now, the Indians were saying that they feel Tim Belcher, the pitching coach, as you look at Shearholtz, getting a real opportunity to play this year. He's delivered some big hits, also a good defensive player. Fly ball to left field. Brantley over to make the catch, two down. The Indians feel that maybe Tim Belcher, the pitching coach, found something mechanical that Carmona was doing in the stretch, but I guess we'll find out tonight.
Yeah, a little hint. I used to play with Tim, but he thought he was hunched over a little bit too much, and it was really cutting down on that thing that Bobby was talking about, being able to open up. And you know, it's not some mechanic that you would teach as far as opening up the lower half as much as he did, but if he stands him up a little taller, it's going to feel more like the windup, and he's going to feel like he's freer. And he's definitely keeping his height right now.
With that leg kick and as few runs as the Giants score, I wouldn't be surprised if Cody tries to steal one here.
It's one of the laments of Bruce Bochy is how little they do in the early innings of games. You go to a Giants game, you blink, and it's the fifth inning, no score.
Lou Marcone, a very good thrower behind the plate, but Carmona is just getting the ball, worrying about the fact that he's not very good out of the stretch. He's a very rhythmic pitcher right now. One look at first base and delivering it to home.
And that's the thing, Bobby, when you have been working a little bit on your mechanics in a particular part of the game, that part of the game consumes you. And so if he's thinking about his posture, thinking about the fact that he struggled from the stretch, he might forget about the running game.
I think he's definitely forgotten about it, and I think Cody Ross is going to wake him up right here. How about that? Good guess?
I like getting out in front of it.
Two down, two balls and a strike as pitching coach Tim Belcher looks on. The lead by Ross. He is not going, and the pitch is lined into left field. A base hit for Bill Hall. Up to second goes Ross.
He threw four pitches with the exact same cadence, exact same leg kick. I don't know if that could have been first and third, and I don't know how much advantage it would be with two outs, but I know the Giants need every little bit they can get.
Well, I tell you what, it not only helps out the runner as far as doing that, but I think it helps out the hitter. When you give that look, I think you can use pitching from the stretch as a way to fool hitters just as much as it does throw the running game off. When you have shorter leg kicks, higher leg kicks take longer to come set, you can mess with the hitter's timing and his psyche.
Now Chris Stewart. He's the catcher and number 8 hitter for the Giants. Buster Posey out for the season. Eli Whiteside's got a bit of a sore quad right now. Stewart starting his third game in a row. As you can see, he has not done much with the bat, but they love his defensive ability, including his arm. Similar story to the one we told for Lou Marson, the Indians catcher. At the knees, much to the surprise of Stewart, who kind of jerked his head to the right suddenly when he heard that it was called strike two.
Now with two strikes, the right fielder's got to creep in here. Earl, I mean, with the pitcher on deck, you can't allow a base hit to score a run. If he happens to hit one into the gap and the guy scores from second, so what? You've got to be able to cut this run down at the plate if you're the right fielder for San Francisco. I mean, for Cleveland.
Yep, and as soon as you get the two strikes, the pitch is usually going to be on the edge of the plate or below the strike zone or above the strike zone for a ball, and if you make the correct pitch, they're going to hit it weakly.
Well, Chris Stewart's in there for his defense, and Whiteside has a little pulled muscle in his leg, so Bruce doesn't want to play him today. It's a doubleheader coming up on Tuesday. Stewart's hitting 156. I think you could go with the chances that this ground ball pitcher, if the ball's hit, it's going to be on the ground. If it's hit to right, you got to throw him out at home or at least hold him at third.
Into right center, a base hit. Ross in to score. Hall around to third, getting the wave home. And all the way around to third goes Stewart, 2-0 Giants.
Well, he was going to hit it in that direction. He hit it a little harder than I think Shelly Duncan thought he would. Couldn't cut this ball off at all. It's not a gapper, as you would say. This is a guy scoring from first on basically a ball that was cut off by the right fielder.
It goes as a two-run double. Stewart taking third on the throw. Here's Madison Bumgarner. And he'll take inside ball one. The Giants with two runs early. Two runs is a big inning for the Giants. They are the worst offensive team in all of baseball.
Well, that felt like a grand slam on their bench.
The two out hit from their eighth hitter is like a grand slam.
Yeah.
With two strikes.
Madison Bumgarner, I'll tell you what, he has been averaging 2.77 runs per start. He feels like he just got the whole game's worth.
Yeah, he just won the lottery. Checks the swing.
It's the third lowest support in the National League. And that's hard to take as a 21-year-old, I'll tell you what. Come up to the big leagues, it'd be nice to get a few more runs than that.
Two balls, two strikes on Bumgarner. Carmona looked great in the first inning. Struck out the first batter here in the second inning. But then gave up the base hit to Ross. Schierholz retired on a fly ball. But then a base hit to Hall. And a two-run double by Chris Stewart. Giants lead 2-0, trying to sweep the series. And again, Carmona this season has done very well, but the bases are empty. But once somebody gets on, once he gets in a little bit of a jam, he seems to be unable to get himself out of trouble. And is that the case here tonight?
Well, Madison's getting to see what the hitters for the Giants are going to see when he gets back on the mound when the Indians are going to be batting. And I'll tell you what, it should help his pitch selection just being out there visually, seeing these shadows and knowing how tough it is to see the ball as a hitter.
Makes some contact, ground ball to second, inning over. But a couple of runs across for the Giants on the double by Chris Stewart. A baseball tonight update when we come back.
make a run. But I'm really interested to see how the Cleveland Indians are going to continue to go out there and do it, Johnny. They have to have someone step up for this team. Have yet to see that guy.
Yeah, and that's what scares you. Now they're going to, if Carmona goes out of the rotation, they're going to have all young starting pitchers, and we know how that goes. Inconsistency with youth. I think this is Detroit's division to win.
Fausto Carmona reportedly pitching for his job tonight. Dan, back to you.
Wendy, John, Barry, thank you. 2-0 Giants as we go to the third inning. And Adam Everett leads it off for the Indians, one of the few real veterans on this team. 36 years of age, longtime Houston Astro. He's also been a Twin and a Tiger. At this point of his career, utility infielder, part-time player. And quickly in the hole, 0-2 against Bumgarner. Bumgarner looking much better than he did on Tuesday against Minnesota when he gave up hits to the first eight batters he faced. Just the second pitcher ever to do that. Zach Duke, then of the Pirates, suffered the same fate back in 2006. Swing and a miss. The shadow's a factor. Everett gone one down. Well, Wendy and the guys were talking a little bit about the American League Central, the Indians division, which usually has manages to find a way to have a very exciting race down the stretch. And right now the Tigers have a half game lead on the Indians. Cleveland was 30-15. They're 10-20 since. Meanwhile, thanks to Paul Konerko and others, the White Sox are only 4.5 out. Kansas City and Minnesota both 9 back. We mentioned Minnesota was playing great ball, as good as anybody in baseball, but then suffered some more injuries. Now they've lost 5 in a row. Carmona sends it foul down the right side. 0-2. Guys, is there one team in particular that intrigues you in the American League Central?
Well, for me, the Chicago White Sox, if Adam Dunn can ever get it going, I just really don't think they've fired on all cylinders. They've kind of hovered around a little below 500. I don't know if they're 3-4 games under, but I look at them as a possible contender almost more than the Indians now.
Bobby?
Totally agree.
Yep.
I don't think the Indians are a contender. I think that they're, you know, going to play out the rest of the season, figure out what they have, bring up some more young guys, evaluate them as the season goes along. But this is a White Sox, Detroit Tiger division. One of them will win it. I think it's going to be the Sox.
Would you have ever thought you would have said that about 3 weeks ago when Ozzie Guillen was so upset and so angry the way his team was playing?
Exactly. It's just, as you mentioned, Dan, they played so poorly. Their bullpen was atrocious. Mm-hmm. Their offense was nothing. They couldn't pick up the ball. They're 4.5 games out. They're a series away from being in first place, and I think they will be in first place before those dog days come in.
Swing and a miss. Carmona is gone 2 down. Let's send it down to Buster Olney.
Guys, I think the Indians are going to stay in it. When you look at the rest of the division and the strengths and the weaknesses, I think the fact that the Indians have such a strong bullpen will keep them in it. And the Minnesota Twins are an interesting team because if they ever decide they're out of it, they got a lot of players on that team from Michael Kadire and others who other teams would love to get in trades. The Twins 3 weeks ago were beginning to indicate they were ready to talk trade. Then they backed off. Maybe this most recent losing streak starts to edge them in the other direction.
All right, Buster, thank you. 2 down here with the Indians third. 2-0. The Giants lead the Indians. Michael Brantley the batter. Maybe one thing we can all agree on in this division is that the Tigers have themselves a pretty good number one pitcher in that rotation right now. Every 5 days, Oral, you can be pretty sure you know what you're going to get from Justin Verlander.
He's absolutely amazing. And you think you're going to get a no-hitter every time he steps on the mound, and you almost get that kind of stuff. And the way he strikes people out in double figures, he's consistent with his mechanics. He's a great athlete. And he's got two pitches that he could tell you they are coming, his fastball or his breaking ball, and they are very hard to hit.
Now throwing that changeup and slider more often, being a complete pitcher, slowed the game down, understands what he has to do to get a hitter out and win a ball game. One of the best in the business, if not the best in the business right now.
One hopper to second. Inning over. 3 out and 3 down to go the Indians against Bumgarner. 2-0 Giants as we go to the bottom of the third with the top of the order coming up for the home team.
Presented by Taco Bell is brought to you by One-A-Day Men's, the official multivitamin of MLB, specially formulated for men. And Visa. More people go with Visa. To the bottom of the third with Bobby Valentine and Oral Hershiser, I'm Dan Schulman. The Giants lead the Indians 2-0. Looking to sweep the series here at AT&T Park and put a little more distance between themselves and the Arizona Diamondbacks, who are currently a game back after their loss to the Tigers earlier today. Top of the order for the Giants, beginning with center fielder Andres Torres. Shows bunt, and bunts right on through it.
He was going to take that one toward the second baseman, just missed the ball when he bunted at it.
Now the count 0-2. We are here at beautiful AT&T Park, the home of the defending World Series champion San Francisco Giants. Sunday Night Baseball presented by Taco Bell on ESPN. The Giants winning 4-3 Friday night, 1-0 yesterday, and leading 2-0 here tonight on a two-run double by Chris Stewart. The pitching matchup tonight, Fausto Carmona, the right-hander on the mound for the Indians, left-hander Madison Bumgarner is the pitcher and doing well so far for the Giants. The Indians just 10-20 in their last 30 games after starting the season 30-15. Bouncer toward first, and an easy play for the first out.
Well, the visibility is getting tougher and tougher from as Madison delivers this ball. Watch it go from light to dark or into the shadows. And then from the batter's perspective, now you see it, now you don't.
It really makes your eye change the lens. It's like focusing your camera in bright sunlight or in the shade. And you have to refocus that camera lens in your eye as the ball's coming to home plate. It's very difficult to do.
As Brandon Crawford steps in. Tap back to the mound his first time up. And he lines a ball to left center field that'll get down for a much needed base hit for Crawford, who would have been struggling coming into this game.
We saw Crawford a couple weeks ago. I liked his approach at the plate. Just looked like he had to start a little sooner. I think he's worried about getting out in front. He wants to wait. This time he started really early. He had a very good approach. As this ball goes away from him, there's the swing. He's set. Comes off the back foot and drives this ball in the left center field. Perfect swing. I think this kid could hit at the major league level as soon as he gets some confidence.
And Bruce Bochy, the shortstop position is one of the decisions he seems to make on a daily basis as he put Crawford out there or Miguel Tejada. They've got Emmanuel Burris and Bill Hall at second. Mike Fontenot on the DL. Sandoval with a base hit through the right side. Crawford racing around second, and he will easily make it into third.
Now this is a ball when you're on first base and you can make the ball be behind you. It means you got a good jump on the ball and you know you're going to go to third. So he gets this jump. The ball's behind him. He's going to third all the way on this ball. If that ball's in front of him, he knows then he doesn't have the same chance of getting to third. Nice base running, nice angle into second. First and third situation created.
Now Aubrey Huff. The Giants with two runs in the second and threatening again here in the third. Swing and a miss by Huff, who struck out his first time up. The Giants are not a big inning team. They have not scored more than six runs in any home game this year.
Yet.
There's always a first time, right? And tonight could be the night. Base hit into right field. Crawford will score. Sandoval to second. 3-0 Giants.
And there you saw the base running antithesis, where Sandoval did not get the good jump off the bat. The ball's in front of him. Consequently, he has to stop at second and not create a first and third situation. Carmona having trouble out of the stretch, Earl.
Yeah, you say that, you know, ground ball, how can you critique that? But I critique the pitch location, because when you're ahead 0-1 with a man on first, you've got to make a better sinker to guard your own defensive liability of having a man on first and your first baseman moved over. And he didn't throw a quality sinker there as far as location and playing to the defense.
Now Cody Ross. The Giants managing just fine with the shadows right now, coming up with three consecutive hits to score a run. And Fausto Carmona's problems persist here for the Indians. A guy with an ERA of almost 9 in his last 8 starts. Meanwhile, Bruce Bochy, I mean, not that he can, you know, kick back and relax, but 3 runs with their pitching staff in this ballpark, that's a pretty good lead. And they haven't lost a game all season when they have led by 3 or more runs.
They're without Brian Wilson tonight.
Yep. Wilson has pitched in 4 consecutive games. And Bochy said that he thinks Brian Wilson would probably be kicking the door down into his office to get a chance to pitch tonight. But no way, no how does Bruce Bochy intend to pitch him on a 5th consecutive day.
No, he'll close this game with Lopez, if it's a left-handed hitter, which might be Travis Hafner as we're looking down the road, or Ramon Ramirez.
As Sergio
he also has Romo.
Romo. Yep. Who didn't pitch yesterday?
So it will be Romo.
3 days
Ramirez,
in a row,
right?
And a foul tip held by the catcher Marson. Ross is gone. 2 down. Coverage of Major League Baseball continues this week on ESPN2. Tomorrow night, Monday Night Baseball, the Cincinnati Reds are down in St. Petersburg to take on the Tampa Bay Rays, who are playing great baseball right now. Then it's Wednesday Night Baseball presented by Sears Lawn and Garden as the Red Sox take on the Phillies. Monday and Wednesday Night Baseball both on ESPN2. How about the Rays, who in a football score today beat the Houston Astros 14-10. Tampa Bay has won 4 in a row. They're in 3rd place in the American League East, but Bobby, they've got the 4th best record in all of baseball. The Phillies are first. Then it goes Yankees, Red Sox, and the Rays. And whoever would have thought that with all of the players the Rays lost in the offseason?
Well, I love what that organization does and love what Joe Maddon does as a manager. And they've done this basically without Longoria hitting the way he can. I think he's still going to hit 30 home runs. That's going to give him 20 plus. From now until the end of the season, I think they're going to make a big run at this pennant.
Maybe today is the day that Longoria starts doing what you're talking about. Hit 2 home runs today in that 14-10 win over Houston. It's an amazing story by the Rays this year with a brand new bullpen. Lost Matt Garza, Bartlett, Crawford, Pena. I mean, lost so many players from last year.
But David Price is a true ace now. He's not a project now. You can count on him every 5th day.
And big game James.
Yep.
My goodness, you know, they had a decision to make a trade, keep Matt Garza or keep big game James. They kept James down there. He has 6 complete games. I guess 3 shutouts. Pitching as well as anyone in baseball.
Here, 3-0 Giants, bottom of the 3rd. Runners at first and second with 2 down and a 2-2 count on the right fielder, Nate Shearholz.
If any of the realignment ideas go through, they'd be right in the rocking chair right now. They'd be make the playoffs as a second wild card team.
I think they like it just where they are. They've been in the playoffs in that division before. They like competing against the big boys. I think they'll continue to compete and continue to do well.
They could add a wild card team in each league without realigning too, which is something that teams like the Rays and the Blue Jays would be very fond of. 3-2 the count. And the runners will be on the move. Sandoval from second and a Huff from first. And Carmona continues to labor. Had a great first inning, struck out the first batter in the second inning. Since then, the Giants are 6-10 against him. And when you look at the raw stuff, Oral, does it, how do you explain a guy with stuff this good getting hit this hard?
Well, once the ball leaves his hand, it's very, very good. He shows the ball a little bit more than others because of the way he strides to the plate and kind of jumps at the hitter, so they get a really good look at him.
Don't see many swings and misses. It's his movement and his stuff that gets his outs.
Yep.
It's not his deception.
And he doesn't have great location. He can throw strikes, but it's not located. It's the difference, you know, you throw great movement, great stuff, but near the middle of the plate and even down, you're going to face probably 6-7 left-handed hitters for sure when you're Carmona as a right-hander. You're going to need something to get them off of you. Usually it's going to be a four-seamer type cutter or a changeup.
And there's nothing that goes inside to a left-hander.
No.
And everything's running away from the left-hander. They don't have, they just cancel out the inside part of the plate. They're looking away. It is very good stuff. It does move, and it's usually down, but it's in that location. Even when you can't see the ball, you can guess where it's going to be.
A bouncer to second to end the inning. But the Giants get another run. Driven in by Aubrey Huff at the end of three. 3-0, San Francisco.
Years old, but these days they're in the midst of a youth movement. But can kids in the lineup, youngsters on the mound and in the pen, upend decades of frustration and failure? 1954, 1995, 1997. Promises never fulfilled. Superstars forever gone elsewhere. But they're at the top of the division now. A flash in the baseball pan? Maybe. But don't tell them that.
They have been so close so many times. We're in the American League Championship Series and up 3-1 on the Red Sox as recently as 2007. And, of course, you heard reference to the 95 and 97 teams that both played in the World Series. Mr. Hershiser spent 3 years pitching and pitching well in Cleveland. Later on in your career with Cleveland, what were those years like and those two World Series like for you?
Those were some amazing years. We played in front of sellouts all the time. We got to the World Series in 95, lost to the Braves. Tom Glavine threw a one-hitter. Dave Justice beat us with a 1-0 game. And then lost in the seventh game of the World Series in 97 in extra innings to the Marlins.
Outside ball one to Orlando Cabrera. The last time the Indians won the World Series was 1948, the second longest drought in a baseball, active drought, next to the Cubs. What a run they had, as Oral was talking about. Oral was there for part of it. From 95 through 2001, they won the division 6 times in 7 years, played in the World Series twice, sold out 455 consecutive games. And with the likes of, boy, Lofton, Baerga, Alomar, Bell, Ramirez, Tomy, Sandy Alomar, who's here tonight. I mean, that lineup was devastating.
Hmm. Went from the mistake on the lake to the Jake, and you were there.
7 runs a game they're averaging.
Orlando Cabrera lines one into left center field. Over to cut it off, Cody Ross. Cabrera goes halfway, puts the brakes on, and goes back. Bill Hall was swiping the tag down on the imaginary runner and didn't know that Cabrera had turned around.
Bobby, you take it, but I'm sitting here going, that is great base running.
You hit the ball and you're thinking double all the way until the outfielder proves to you that it's a single. And Orlando, at 36 years old, hits this ball out of the box. He's thinking double. He takes a great turn around first base. He's going. He looks up. The outfielder says it's not a double. It's a single. Puts on the brakes. Safe.
He did not leave on the timing of the outfielder's throw. He read the angle to make sure the throw was going to be at the bag. If that ball would have been thrown on the same time, different angle, he'd have gone.
As Drubal Cabrera backs him up with a base hit, and the Indians are in business here. 2 on with nobody out in the fourth. You know, Orlando Cabrera is a guy, the numbers suggest, guys hitting around 240. Doesn't have a lot of pop. Not the most productive player in the game, but we've talked about it before. The playoffs have a way of following him around, got some leadership qualities, good with the younger players, and his name has started to come out there as a guy who, if the Indians fall out of contention, or even if they don't, they've got some good young infielders they might want to bring up from the minors, that maybe Cabrera could be on the move to play a number of spots. And the Giants are one team that has been mentioned with the problems they're having at second and short.
He plays the game with the details, and that attracts winning.
Carlos Santana, fly ball, shallow left center, and caught by Torres. One down, down to Buster Olney.
Guys, before the game, it was interesting. I saw Orlando Cabrera go up and shake hands with Bruce Bochy. Look, Bochy knows that last year when this team won the World Series, it was with veterans like Orlando Cabrera. I agree with you, Dan. That's something to keep an eye on as we go forward.
And Brian Sabian, the general manager of the Giants, is not a shy man. He's been known to make moves in the middle of the season. And he'll, you know, Cody Ross was a guy. Nobody thought it was going to be that big of a move when it was made last year. Maybe a guy like Orlando Cabrera can really help the fortunes of the San Francisco Giants, who are looking for stability and offense at a number of positions. There's a fair ball pulled down to first. Huff will make the play to retire Sizemore. The runners advance, 2 down.
Well, one of the things you like to watch when you watch a veteran player play and you say he plays the details, you watch a secondary lead. You watch to see if he's relaying signs. You watch to see if he's instructing his teammates around him when he's out there on defense. You see him on the bench analyzing the pitcher and the repertoire. You know, there are just so many things, and those little things are huge.
Absolutely, Earl. He plays the game the way you want everybody to play the game. He thinks the game the way you want everyone to think the game. He could help a team win a championship, whether it's Cleveland or San Francisco or another team this year. And I think he'll help teams in the future as a coach and possible manager. He's a baseball man.
Somebody like Alex Cora, same kind of guy.
There's Shelly Duncan. The Indians got the first 2 men on this inning. At first and second, now they're at second and third, but with 2 down as they try to get something going against Madison and Bumgarner, who has proven that he is over what happened to him on Tuesday night when he only got 1 out and gave up 8 runs on 9 hits.
At 20 years old, his first year in the big leagues, he goes 7-6 with a 2.9 ERA. Now, the record is not very good this year. He's got a chance, if he would lose today, to be the first one in the National League to lose 10 games at 3-9. But they've given him 2.77 runs per game. He's a quality big league pitcher.
And this is his biggest at bat of the game thus far. Shelly Duncan went in to this at bat being very lackadaisical. I think he was just trying to pick up the ball, took 2 strikes, got down 2-0, got a very aggressive swing and an 0-2 fastball, saying pitch he struck out on the first time up. Now you think that this ball is going to be down and in. Let's see if he can make an adjustment.
Bottom of the pitch down and away to strike him out as the Indians leave a couple of men on in the fourth.
Baseball presented by Taco Bell. To the bottom of the fourth inning at AT&T Park in San Francisco. The Giants 3 and the Indians nothing. Time now for FaceTime presented by Edward Jones. Buster Olney spoke with Indians manager Manny Acta between innings.
Manny Acta, what are you seeing so far in Fausto Carmona?
Well, I see good stuff, but still, you know, he has to step back whenever he's back against the wall and need to pitch instead of throw. Those are those type of situations where we feel he needs to go with his number one pitch and not allowed to get hit on his secondary pitches.
What's the biggest adjustment he has to make with runners on base?
It's that one. It's recognize that, you know, he needs to go to number one, that sinker. That's the one who's made it who he is. And so far this year, he has given up way too many big hits, especially home runs to right-handed hitters to slider and changeups.
Manny, thanks. Dan, back to you.
Buster, thank you. So there's the assessment that the manager, Manny Acta, has on Fausto Carmona. Way too many big hits, way too many hits on sliders and changeup. That was a first pitch slider there that he got a swing and a miss from Bill Hall on. But Carmona continues to perplex the Indians. He's had a 19-win season. Then 2 years later, they sent him down to rookie ball to get himself straightened out. Came back last year, won 13, pitched well, was the opening day starter this year. And now he's got an ERA of almost 9 in his last 8 starts.
He's a very distinct delivery in the fact that he operates on the edge, Dan. And you can see when he's that much on the edge, he kept it together in 07 and really put it together. But he has a tendency to want to jump at the hitter and use a lot of rotational energy from his shoulders and his upper body to throw the ball. That's where you get that little herky-jerky at the end right as he strides. And the difference being able to do that from the windup and getting some linear motion, some forward motion out of his back leg, compared to not having that forward motion out of his back leg when he's in the stretch. So he ends up really kind of spinning like a top when he's from the stretch without any momentum going towards the plate, which flattens his pitches out, leaves them up, especially his slider and his changeup, and leaves him with just an arm, really.
Let's take a look now at our pro tips, Oral, brought to you by Cabot Woodstains. More on Carmona.
On the left side is the windup. You'll watch him come to the top of his leg kick, and the back leg will start moving him towards home plate, and his front shoulder is high. You see the high elbow. But from the stretch, the back leg is dead, and all the velocity and all the movement from the stretch comes from spinning, where from the windup, he's coming forward. He's got a little higher arm angle, and he can drive the ball down to the plate. But from the stretch, it's more side-to-side and rotational. It makes the ball flat, you lose velocity, you lose movement, and you show the ball to the hitter a little bit sooner.
Here's Chris Stewart, had the big two-run double with two outs in the second inning. Runner is going. Throw down on a bounce and into center field. Hall back to his feet, digging for third.
That's Bruce Bochy understanding the situation that Carmona has not paid any attention to the runners, hasn't thrown over there at all. This was not a hit and run. It's a straight steal. Hall takes off early. Cabrera can't pick the ball. The ball might have beaten him, but there's no way of picking that long throw. Goes into center field. And another opportunity for the Giants. They might break this thing open with 4 runs. My goodness, what an explosion.
The infield is in for the Indians. Ground ball down to third. Knocked down by Adam Everett and on to first to get him. Hall holding at third.
Remember, Adam Everett was one of the better shortstops around when he was down in Houston. He had some cat-like reflexes there. Just reacts and gets down there. Makes sure he keeps the ball in front of him. Falls to his knees just to visually grab it. Hits him in the heel of the glove. Doesn't speed up the game at all. Knows the ball was hit really hard, had plenty of time to make the throw.
And knows there's no out, so the runner will not be going on contact. So he has plenty of time to just pick it up and get the one out at first. Contact might be here on a high hopper.
Swing and a miss by Bumgarner. A rare left-handed thrower, right-handed batter. Don't see many of those. No, retired on a ground ball his first time up.
I'm sorry, Dan, mainly because your left arm's exposed to the pitcher here. If he has one of those sinkers come running in and hits him on the elbow, he's out for 3 weeks. Whoops, this squeeze.
Yep.
And they got the runner Hall caught up in a rundown between third and home. Missed sign by Bumgarner?
Yes.
It's a perfect time to squeeze. I was up here, but we didn't have enough time before the pitch. And I'm going, this is perfect after a swing and a miss by your pitcher.
Yeah, this is a visual sign to the runner. So the third base coach tells the runner to squeeze on. This is a hand sign to the batter, who usually signals I've got it by giving an answer to the third base coach. I guess they don't have an answer. Consequently, it's a swing and an out.
Yep. A confirmation could be anything from take your bat and tap the plate to rub the top of your helmet as you get back in the box. Anything to tell the third base coach and the runner you received the sign.
So just like that, two down in the inning, nobody on. You know, a check swing foul off. And it goes as a caught stealing, 2-5-3 on the putout. Santana came down the line from first to apply the tag in the rundown. Little looper to shallow left center, and it is dropped. Sizemore, the center fielder, with the proverbial can of corn. And whether the sun got him, he can't believe that he dropped that ball, charged with an error.
No, he had plenty of time. This ball is toward the sun, but the sun did not distract him. He just whiffed it as the ball hit the heel of his glove. Actually hit the fingers as he was closing the glove. Careless mistake.
So Bumgarner at first with two down. An error on Sizemore, and here's Torres.
You know, when you have the winds here in San Francisco, back in Candlestick it was even worse, but there's nothing routine, even about a routine pop up or fly. You have to take it every last inch into your glove.
Between the wind, the shadows, the sun, the glare.
The pitcher hit it. There were two outs. He was going to catch it and come trotting in. And just anytime you take anything for granted in this game, the game sneaks up and captures you.
Two errors committed this inning by the Indians, one by Lou Marson, the throwing error, one by Grady Sizemore. Sizemore's first error of the season. Defense a big problem for Cleveland in this series. Santana committed the two errors in the same inning Friday when the Giants scored three runs. And then Cord Phelps, the second baseman, committed two errors in the same inning yesterday when the Giants scored the only run of the game on error, error, walk, balk. That's how San Francisco got the run of the 1-0 win. And as Bruce Bochy said, he's surprised the Indians showed up today after the beating the Giants put on him yesterday. Tongue planted firmly in cheek.
But when you talk about the Cleveland Indians and their great start, they played stellar defense. They got great clutch hitting. And as is mentioned by Buster, they had great relief pitching. To think that that's going to be your formula for success when you don't have stellar defensive players standing out there. They have one, possibly two above average defensive players. And your hitters are not experienced to the point where you could say that their track record tells you they're going to hit in the clutch. Firing the hitting coach isn't going to make them hit any better. You just have to get more experience and a little more quality. Hence, I don't think that they're in it, and we'll see how the season progresses.
I mean, the irony is in this inning, the two players who committed the errors are two of the best defenders they've got out there, in Marson the catcher and Sizemore in center field. Let's get an update now. Hunter Wendelstedt, the home plate umpire, took a foul ball off the side of his mask about the area of his right cheek, had to leave the game in the second inning. We've been working with three umpires ever since. Buster Olney's got an update.
Guys, I talked to Jerry Lane, who's filled in home plate between innings, and he told me that Hunter Wendelstedt is getting checked out by an umpire for precautionary reasons. They think that he's okay, but Jerry Lane wanted to get that out there to Hunter's family.
And he stayed in for the rest of the half inning, stayed in the game for about another 5 minutes when the inning ended, though. That was all for Hunter Wendelstedt. And hopefully nothing serious for him as Jerry Lane takes over behind the plate. Brandon Crawford is the batter.
And just for a note there, Oral saw it, and as you were talking, Dan, Tim Belcher went to the mound after a walk to the leadoff hitter after the third out should have been made in center field. And Belcher was trying to get Cremona to get his head on. Don't worry about what happened in the field. This is the out you need to get.
0-2.
That concentration part of the game, if you will, or that competitive part of the game, you have to eliminate distractions and you have to go after this pitch right now. Forget about the past and go for it.
Oral, when you were a pitching coach and you went out to the mound, give me quickly, what percentage was I'm talking to my pitcher about mechanics and what percentage was I'm talking to my pitcher about his mental or emotional approach?
A lot of it was more mental and emotional, because if it's mechanics and you're out there competing, unless it's something you've worked on in the bullpen that you put a tool in their tool belt, you don't want to introduce something physically that's brand new out there that they're not sure they can trust. And in competition, it's hard to trust. So you're really trying to refocus them mentally on the situation.
And the inning is over. An interesting inning. Two errors, but no runs for the Giants. 3-0. San Fran at the end of four. Continue to lead the Indians 3-0. Now time for more FaceTime, presented by Edward Jones. Buster Olney with Giants manager Bruce Bochy between innings.
Bruce Bochy, Madison Bumgarner in his last start, he really struggled. How did he respond to that? What are you seeing tonight?
Well, he's done a great job. I'm proud of him, the way he went out there and threw strikes. You know, he got tested last inning, and I thought that's when we would find out how he would bounce back. And first two guys got base hits, and he settled down. He got out of that. It's all about bouncing back, being resilient. He's done a great job. He just missed the squeeze sign, though, which didn't help him.
Now, you guys have already scored 3 runs tonight. Compared to how you've done this year, that's a lot of runs. In so many close games, how does that affect how you manage?
Well, you try to get all the runs you can. They're a premium. And as you just saw, I mean, we stole a base, and we tried to squeeze in a run. You do all you can to get runs, especially in this ballpark. And so it's a team that, you know, we know we're not going to put up a lot of runs. So we got to execute. Last inning got away from us, but I'm proud of how the guys are finding ways to win ball games right now.
Bruce, thanks. Dan, back to you.
Buster, thank you. Lou Marson goes around and strikes out for the first out here in the fifth inning. The fifth strikeout tonight for Bumgarner, who definitely has bounced back well from Tuesday night. And again, last year, at the age of 20, as a rookie, went 2-0 with a 2.18 ERA in the postseason. He was a major factor in the Giants' run to the World Series championship. Adam Everett, the batter. But as Bruce Bochy said, he did miss a squeeze sign last inning. Shocking Bill Hall as he was racing down the line from third.
Even shocked more when he swung the bat. Bill Hall is coming in. You always hope the hitter is going to square around, but then when he doesn't square around and he swings, it's a suicide squeeze. That's why they call it a suicide squeeze play. If you don't get it down, you are dead. And if they hit a line drive and you're running towards it, you're even deader.
Two and two.
The guy they squeeze with usually doesn't hit many line drives. He's that bad, you put it on.
Would you suicide squeeze a lot, Bobby, with your pitcher?
Yes.
With your pitcher, yeah?
Yes. Yeah. My pitcher, my eighth place hitter. I would even done it on the first play as soon as he got around the third. And everyone's thinking about the error and the ball being thrown into center field before they even remember or figure out that there's a man on third. I'd like to squeeze and get it down.
And the count was 0-1. Hall at third. Here he comes racing down the line.
Oh,
the big leg kick in the swing. And the hands reflexively went up in front of the face for Bill Hall.
You can really disguise it as a hitter if you want to have that big leg kick and then flip right down into your bunting position. Go Sarhara O. Oh, I'm bunting.
Buster Olney, who's down in the camber bay on the third base side of the field, is reporting an audible gasp from Bill Hall on his way down the line at third when he realized that Bumgarner would miss the sign.
Again, we talked over quickly, but just for that edification to what happens there, the third base coach verbally tells the guy on third to squeeze his on. Then he gives a hand signal to the hitter, and often the hitter will signal back to the coach, say, okay, I know it's a squeeze, so that doesn't happen.
Lazy fly ball to shallow center, two down.
Some teams have become proficient at watching the hitter in those squeeze situations and not trying to pick up the sign from the third base coach, but pick up the answer from the hitter. So some teams, as I'm sure the Giants, have gone away from the old philosophy of giving the response or answer to the squeeze. And
I used to give the answer on every pitch.
Exactly.
Give the answer on every pitch on purpose.
But that's because we knew that he would have the squeeze.
Right.
Now, somebody else, you say, hey, give the answer on every pitch. Well,
doesn't really
compute because they say, I wonder if he's got it. That's what he did the pitch before.
You didn't miss many signs?
Not really.
No,
I don't think so. That was the fun part of the game. I mean, it's the fun part of the game for watch even from up here. The intricacies, the way to beat the opponent when the opponent has the same ability you have. And you come to a level where you can't out-ability them, but you can out-think them. Mm-hmm. You can out-strategize them.
And a lot of times, Oral would be thinking along with you, so there wouldn't be a surprise. Madison was surprised by that sign. That's why he didn't get it.
He was so surprised. He didn't get it.
He swung and missed, and he was so into, oh, what do I have to do to try to drive this run in and try to make contact? He forgot to anticipate. Yep.
It might have been the first time he received a squeeze in an 0-1 count in his life at 21 years old.
Swing and a miss by Carmona to end the inning. Five shutout innings for Madison Bumgarner. 3-4-5. Sandoval, Huff, and Ross do up for the Giants.
It's the whole thing. Makes the cross, goes in.
Bottom of the fifth inning here in San Francisco. Dan Shulman, Oral Hershiser, Bobby Valentine, Buster Olney. Sunday Night Baseball on ESPN, presented by Taco Bell. The Giants 3, the Indians nothing. Pablo Sandoval, 1-for-2, leads it off against Fausto Carmona. Now here's what the Panda does before each at bat. He gets into the box, then he goes out of the box into fair territory. Goes through that routine. And wait, there's more. Then he gets back into the box, and then he steps out of the box again, but this time where he is now. And then he finally gets back into the box. But is it a breach of etiquette, guys, for a hitter to go into fair territory, which he does before every at bat? And again, this is just, I mean, this is just his routine, his thing. There's a little bit of, hey, notice me, everybody. With, you know, Sandoval's not a shy guy, and they love him here. They're selling panda hats and panda this and that like crazy here in San Francisco. But Oral, is a pitcher waiting on the mound for the inning to begin. How would you feel about that?
They're more fun to get out.
Yeah, just part of his ritual.
Yep. Yeah, you just let it go. But
of course, the better he hits, the more the Giants will put up with his idiosyncrasies. And boy, they're happy to get him back off the DL last week.
Yeah, and he went 60 at-bats with only hitting singles. He had 19 singles, and here in his first 61st at-bat, he gets a double. Good viewing for the old Giant fans. That's that sinker that they want to throw. He throws it. And the Panda hit it the way it's supposed to be done.
And this is a guy, Sandoval, who 2 years ago was one of the best hitters in the National League. Hit 330 on the season, but saw his weight balloon last year, dropped down to 268. Aubrey Huff is the batter. And a bouncer to second will move the runner. Sandoval actually had gotten so heavy and was hitting so poorly that he became an extra guy in the playoffs a lot last year. He wasn't much of a factor at all. Was out of the lineup as much as he was in at times. But dedicated himself to getting in shape, losing some weight, losing a fair bit of weight. And the broken hamate bone, the broken bone in his wrist this year. But when he's been healthy, he's once again become a fixture in their lineup. Infield in again for the Indians. The batter, Cody Ross.
And then Aubrey Huff, the fourth place hitter for the Giants, just did what Shelly Duncan could not do in the first inning. That's advanced the runner to third base with one out. Both of these teams need to play that kind of fundamental baseball. The Giants just did it. We'll see if they could cash in. But Huff got a big high five when he came into the dugout. And he's the number four hitter who just hit a ground ball to get the high five.
Way inside. Both of these teams struggle offensively. The Giants all the time. The Indians more so recently. So fundamental baseball is so important.
You don't always get paid for that out, but you get job security because that guy right there and anybody else sitting in the manager's seat knows who the winning players are, who makes the productive outs, who sacrifices themselves. And day in and day out, you will get a job year in and year out.
I'll tell you, with this style of baseball the Giants have played, and the phrase was coined as torture last year by former major leaguer and current Giants broadcaster Dwayne Kuiper, because every game is so tense and so close, and the Giants seem to, you know, get in their own way as much as succeed sometimes, but they find a way to win. But Bruce Bochy looks like the most relaxed guy in the ballpark right now, and all the time. Look at that, 63 out of 77 by 3 runs or less, 33 one-run games, but they find a way to win them. They're 22-11 in one-run games this year, including two of them in this series.
This year it's called scratch and claw.
Well, yesterday's a perfect example. It's a scoreless game, and Nate Schierholz leads off the bottom of the seventh with a double. And trips and falls between second and third, is tagged out, So the Giants are thinking, well, there goes our chance to score a run. Two errors, a walk, and a balk later, they get that run, and then the bullpen does the rest. And that's really one of the big stories for the Giants, both of these teams, really. The great bullpens that they have. Once they get a lead, they hold a lead.
And that's the similarity between these two teams, but that's where the similarity stops. The Giants have the guys in the middle of the diamond who start the game and pitch better. They have the veterans who play the game of baseball the right way and have built courage and confidence in the past by doing it before at the major league level. And there's no way, no substitute for experience. Experience is what builds courage and confidence in these situations.
Bobby, if you had a pitcher that was a starter that had 141 point difference in batting average against from the stretch to the windup, wouldn't you let him wind up right here?
He strikes out Ross, two down.
He didn't need it, but I'm pitching from the windup.
Well, he'll need it here also against the left-handed hitter. The answer was yes.
Yeah.
And Cody got himself out swinging at two pitches that were really running in. Piranha balls are running in off the plate, a little too anxious. Knows that he loves the ball in, got him in, but balls were in further than where he can hit and handle.
So runner at third, two down. The infielder's back up. Nate Scherholz out in front, and the count is 0-1.
Problem with pitching out of the windup here is you have Buck and Bob Davidson still perched out there at third, and you stand on that mound as though you're going to go into a windup, and you blink your eye, he might call another Buck.
He was the home plate umpire yesterday and called the balk on Tony Sipp that brought in the only run of the game. A well-earned reputation, balking Bob Davidson. 0-2.
And he never makes it up. He always sees exactly what the pitcher does. He's on them. When they do something that is against the rule book definition of a balk, he calls it, and he always gets it right. It upsets an enormous amount of players in the game because very often it's a very trivial move that doesn't mean, you know, that he was deceiving the runner or starting his motion and stopping his motion. But he's on it every time.
Let's take a look at the balk in yesterday's game. Tony Sipp was on the mound. A scoreless game. Watch the left arm. Start, stop. That was it. You can't have much less of a balk be a balk than that. But Tony Sipp said, I did balk. And Manny Acta didn't come out to argue. And the Giants will take it.
For young players, that situation might happen. Continue to come to your set. You know it's the wrong sign. You haven't communicated properly with the catcher. And then step off after you come set. Don't flinch and start down. Start up. You think it's that? Oh, it's not. Just keep going. Some set. Then step off.
The rule book says you cannot, when you're in the stretch, start your motion and stop your motion. You must completely go to a stop and then step off. He started and stopped without going to his set position. Therefore, it was a ball.
Yeah. It's a nice little flinch.
Sharply hit, knocked down, picked up as Drupal Cabrera throws him out, and the Giants can't extend the lead. 3-0 at the end of five of the Baseball Tonight update on the other side.
and 5 since losing Albert Pujols. So the NL Central, are they in trouble?
Yeah, I think they are in trouble. And 3-12 in the last 15. This is a team that really doesn't have a direction. Certainly Tony La Russa has been very successful in putting guys in position to be successful. But I don't know if he quite has the pieces. I think Albert Pujols meant just so much to this ball club.
Yeah, he made everyone on that team better. But another reason is the Milwaukee Brewers are so good. Their starting pitching has been fantastic. John Axford at the back end of the game, he struggled early in the season, but he's really picked it up. And they have those Braun and Fielder in the middle of that lineup, two of the best in the game.
Dan Shulman, back to you inside.
Wendy, thank you very much. As we go to the sixth inning, a 3-0 lead for the Giants over the Indians. And a strike taken by the left fielder, Michael Brantley.
I couldn't agree with Barry and John more. It seems like it's Milwaukee's division to lose to me.
They are 3 up right now on St. Louis, 4 up on both Cincinnati and Pittsburgh. Cincinnati lost to Baltimore today. Pittsburgh lost to the Red Sox, but still took 2 out of 3 in the series. And there you can see the updated standings in the National League Central. The Pirates at almost the midway point of the season, a game above 500, trying to hit the 500 mark for the first time since 1992.
And Cincinnati going back to that 500 mark where they've been, I think, 7 times this year, never going below 500. And then they had that 3 over that they were above for the first 4 games of the season. But since they've never broken that plateau.
Meanwhile, as the evening progresses, shadows across the infield right now, but still a tough sun for the right fielder.
Line drives are treacherous to right field right now. Pop-ups are fine. Fly balls are fine. Line drives, I don't know where they are. On every swing of the bat, he'll be flinching, wondering where is the ball going to come out of that sun. He's trying to be turned, which is a smart thing to do, so that you could be turned and maybe get the ball out of the sun as quickly as possible.
No play down the left field line for Cody Ross. You know, between we talked about the sun and the wind and the glare, the bullpens down the line, all the nooks and crannies in the right field wall. This is not a routine place to play defense.
It's not routine, and it's really difficult when the American League comes in here for only the 3-game stretch. It's okay when you're coming in here every year a few times, but first time in, everything seems to be out of kilter.
Mm-hmm. Just not enough reps.
Brantley aboard to begin the sixth inning. Well, we showed you what Nate Sherholtz is dealing with in terms of the sun right now. But what about right field, which probably has as many different surfaces and angles as any part of any fence or wall anywhere in a Major League Baseball? As you can see, all the different things, all the different bounces you could get.
That's only half of them.
That's only half of them. It's all different angles that the ball will ricochet off the wall and come at you in different directions. It's a great place for inside the park home runs if you can hit it that far.
Mm-hmm. Orlando Cabrera, the batter. That is a fair ball, says home plate umpire Jerry Lane, and it's going to go as a double. Remember, the game is being played right now with only 3 umpires after the injury earlier to Hunter Wendelstedt, and there was no umpire at third base on that play. So it's the home plate umpire's call, and Bruce Bochy doesn't like it one bit.
Well, once again, practice gives you courage, and practice gives you the ability to do something properly. This is not a call that the home plate umpire at the major league level often makes. He's left kind of naked here, and it's a little late on the call. His reaction is the ball's foul. Oh, wait a minute, this is my call, I have to get out there. He signals fair, as this ball is obviously foul. Not his fault, he's not used to doing it.
And of course,
oh God, it's my call.
And look at the catcher, Chris Stewart, can't believe the call. Now, again, because it had bounced once already, it's where it was when it went over the bag. It landed just foul, just beyond the bag. Cabrera with a ground ball to short. This will get a run home.
Yeah, it could have been ruled fair with it bouncing in foul territory beyond the bag, as long as the ruling was that when it was going over the bag, it was over the bag, and that's fair ball.
It was fair, and that wasn't a good call, and that also was not a good at-bat by Cabrera, batting third in this order, men on second and third, three runs down. He swings at the first pitch very weakly on a pitch down and in to get an RBI. Of course, the infield's back, you know, get the RBI, but I think Manny Rick would have rather seen a better at-bat there. You're going to hit a ground ball, you have to hit it to the right side to advance the runners to second and from second and third. This way, he only advanced one of them.
Yeah, Santiago Casilla, the right-hander, just getting up now in the Giants' pen. So it's 3-1 with a runner at second, one out. The Indians batting here in the sixth inning. Santana 0-2 on the night. Madison Bumgarner is at 89 pitches right now as the bullpen begins to work behind him. And he strikes out Santana, two down.
Well, before the disaster, his last outing, he had a string of 10 quality starts. Then he goes a third of an inning, gives up 9 hits, gets knocked out very early in that game. But you know what? He has gotten back on the horse. Bruce Bochy said he was very proud of the first jam that he pitched through tonight. And he's continued that even in a little traffic to make quality pitches.
And quality up in the zone with two strikes, or where you throw it just a little above the strike zone, it's the most difficult pitch for anyone to hit. If you throw it 90 and you throw it up, it's much more difficult than throwing, hitting a ball down. And he knows how to do that, especially with two strikes. Elevates that strike zone.
Grady Sizemore has doubled and grounded out.
And earlier we talked about hitting with runners in scoring position. You had two young hitters there, Cabrera and Santana. In a momentum inning, men on second and third and no outs, both having very poor at bats with pitch selection and maybe over aggressiveness, but not being giving you the kind of at bats you need in a pennant winning situation. They'll learn the more they do it, but you can't teach experience.
The Indians yesterday in their loss were 0-8 with runners in scoring position. Tonight they are 0-6 with runners in scoring position. Yes, on the season they are first in the league, but they have been under 200 the last 3 weeks or so. The numbers have been dipping quickly. They've been averaging only about 3 runs per game over their last 21 games. Just under that, in fact.
Maybe the approach that Grady has right now, I'm not sure he can hit a pitch that's on the inside part of the plate. Mm-hmm. He has a little dive with the front foot in towards the plate, wraps the bat a little.
Chases the breaking ball and the inning is over. Strikeout number 8 for Madison Bumgarner.
Baseball presented by Taco Bell. We go to the bottom of the sixth inning at AT&T Park. A 3-1 lead for the Giants as they look to sweep this three-game series from the visiting Cleveland Indians. Bill Hall is going to lead it off. He has singled, walked, stolen a base, scored a run. Seen his life flash before his eyes earlier tonight on a botched suicide squeeze.
And had a great secondary lead and great jump on the double right center field that he scored from first on incredibly.
A ball that didn't get anywhere close to the track. Now swinging a chopper to short. As Drubal Cabrera in time for the first out. Well, kind of just eased that throw over there. A little bit low, but he gets the out. Activity now in the Indians panel. Left-hander Rafael Perez is up. A big part of what is statistically the best bullpen in the American League. So we'll see how much longer Fausto Carmona is going to be in the game as Chris Stewart steps in. Led by closer Chris Perez, who has not pitched in a while. You can see four of the relievers in the Indians pen are among the top 11 in the American League in reliever ERA. And Perez is having a very fine season as the closer as well. A lot of different looks, side armors, three quarters guys, nasty sliders. Just out of play.
I think there are teams that know that they're buyers that are looking closely at the bullpen of the Cleveland Indians. And I know that Chris and Mark, who are running the show over in Cleveland, have got to be thinking about getting some good young players to continue to build this organization with a couple of the pieces they have down there in their bullpen. Mark Shapiro's a master at that.
You know, they've gotten some great pieces over the years when they've been forced to trade players like Cliff Lee or CC Sabathia. Kind of a rebuilding project after the ALCS team in 2007. The young players they got back, quality players, a lot of them on the 25-man roster right now.
And the general manager now, Chris Antonetti, is looking at this team. And they have to make a decision here in the next few weeks. If we're going to be in it to win it the rest of the year, or is this a situation where we have to continue to build? And, you know, relief pitchers are what everyone's looking for right now. And they have five quality arms down there that could help teams win a pennant if Cleveland decides they're not one of those in it to win it.
Especially this year, there's not going to be a lot of high-end starting pitchers available. And the bullpen pieces then become more valuable. And you might get an extra piece here and there that somebody actually overpays to you. That'll really help solidify an organization for the future.
Hooked foul.
And the more you look at Carmona, you could see the mechanical situation that Tim Belcher is faced with. The harder he tries to throw the ball, the more his bottom side opens up, the more the ball will run inside on right-handed hitters. And eventually, he's a big, strong guy, but eventually he's going to hurt his arm. He's now stepping about 6 inches further toward the first base dugout when he strides, and he was at the beginning of the game or when he warms up. That foot comes down and he just tries to say, I'm going to throw this really hard, and he's so open that the ball's going to move if he gets on the inside part of the ball, but it's going to put stress on the arm and really play havoc with your control.
Yep.
Is it fixable? Is he fixable?
Well, Tim Belcher knows just as much as any other pitching coach, and you have to not only have the knowledge, but you have to have a patient that's willing to take the surgery. And it's real hard to have surgery up here. You really want to do smaller, finer adjustments. Well, he might think about moving him on the rubber. he might think about, you know, giving him some different cues to try and find one cue that'll fix two or three things.
Ball four.
I've been in uniform with Tim Belcher, one of the smarter guys that I've been around. Mm-hmm. I know that he's going to give his best effort. I know he knows what needs to be done, but like Oral says, the patient has to understand he's ill and want to have it fixed before you're really fixable.
And sometimes you can fix it. When we first saw him take the mound tonight in warm-ups, we go, you know what, that looks a lot better. But as soon as he got under competition, it started to come apart.
Bumgarner, the batter, shows bunt and bunts it foul. Bumgarner, if you were with us earlier, missed the squeeze sign earlier tonight, resulting in Bill Hall getting caught in a rundown between third and home. So Bumgarner is going to be doubly sure that he's got the signs this time. Gets it down. And the sacrifice moves the runner to second. This is the play earlier tonight when Bumgarner missed the sign. Bill Hall coming home and whoop, got to put the brakes on and go back. And eventually got tagged out in the rundown. And this is his reaction after saying, man, he missed the sign. And I went, oh, man, or something to that effect.
I don't think that word started with an M.
The first word was O.
I think you got that right.
Yes. I ad-libbed a little bit on the second word. But you know what? I can't blame him.
Well played, Shulman.
Here's Torres. Look good, but no, ball one. That's got to be a scary feeling.
I've never had it. They won't squeeze with me standing on third, but they'll squeeze with me at the plate.
I don't know if I've ever had it either. First game I was ever in the big leagues, I pinch ran and I went around the third base, and Danny Ozark said, you could steal third base, you could steal home plate on this pitch. And I thought he was kidding. Next pitch was hit, and I was gonna steal.
That's got to be a scary moment for a kid in his first game.
First big league game, and they give him permission to steal home.
Those were the days when the pitcher always pitched out of the windup when you're on third base. You know.
But how fast were you? I mean, you.
I was real fast.
Well, you must have been way above average. I mean,
in fact, I was the fastest guy on the team, maybe in the organization. In the organization, I won the camp race. Remember the O'Malley?
Oh, yeah, we used to do that. Yeah, that was fun.
So I was 19 years old. I ran around the third base, and Danny says, you can steal home in this pitch. And I looked up, and I said, now? And he said, now.
Wow.
And I waited. Ball was hit. Lost my opportunity.
But the next pitch you would have gone?
I was going to go. Yeah.
Even though you weren't 100% sure that he wasn't kidding.
Oh, I was sure he wasn't kidding. Okay. Once I said really,
he said
really.
He says now, you know.
I swear I was going to go.
Okay.
But the ball was hit. Willie Davis was the hitter. Got a base hit. Who could he even do? I would have liked to stolen home. I did it a few times in minor leagues. Maybe eight.
Inning over. 3-1 Giants at the end of six.
ESPN Sunday Night Baseball, presented by Taco Bell, is brought to you by Michelin, a better way forward. We go to the seventh here in San Francisco. As we take you into the evening, a beautiful shot of the Bay Bridge. Such a fantastic place to watch a ball game. Day game, night game, doesn't matter. The Giants leading the Indians 3-1 here on Sunday Night Baseball. And a defensive change for the Giants. Miguel Tejada has taken over for Pablo Sandoval at third base, and we believe that something was bothering Sandoval when he got to third as a runner. As Bumgarner starts Shelly Duncan with a slow breaking ball for a strike. Sandoval was running the bases back in the fifth inning. Outside, a ball and a strike. This was Sandoval, fifth inning, advancing from second to third on a ground ball and pulled up a little bit shy of the bag. And after that, was seen just for a moment kind of bent at the waist, talking with his third base coach, Tim Flannery. Didn't appear to be serious. He stayed in the game, but an inning and a half later, he's now come out of the game. If we get anything further, we'll let you know.
I think something happened on the ball that was hit the right field that went in front of him. He hesitated and let the ball go in front of him.
Duncan strikes out for the third time. Here's after he gets to the bag. Now that can be just kind of catching your breath, but.
Nope.
No, it looked like a little bit more than that as you watched it further.
He was saying he was all right, but I think by the time he got to the dugout, he said, no, this isn't the way it should be. There it goes. Little quad, left quad strain. It's my guess. Oral, your thoughts?
He's given us some clues.
Madison Bumgarner, meanwhile, has set a new career high with 9 strikeouts, so a pretty good way to bounce back from the worst performance of his career on Tuesday. All of them swinging strikeouts tonight, incidentally.
Really liked the interview with Bruce Bochy, saying he was proud of the way Madison bounced back. You know, a manager takes such pride in knowing the player, feeling that they understand the guys who can, the guys who can't, the ones who will get up off the mat when they're down and can keep fighting. And Bruce saw that in this young man. He was looking for number 10 there.
Just missed away. 2 balls, 2 strikes. Right back at him. Right field and dropping for a base hit for Marson, and it looked like Schierholz didn't pick up that ball off the bat.
Yeah, that wasn't the sun. That was just a misread swing. The ball was inside, inside out jam where Schierholz broke back 3 strides. Sun was not a factor, but as he broke back then tried to recover, the ball was in front of him and he had no chance. That was a 3-stride back before that ball reached its apex.
So down 2 runs. The Indians have a man on here in the 7th for Adam Everett. With the pitcher spot due up next, the on-deck circle occupied at the moment by Fausto Carmona, but you know somebody else is going to come up and hit.
Well, it's Austin Kearns. I don't think there's any need to play coy here.
Well,
they have one right-handed pinch hitter that they can run up there, and Austin's a guy who could possibly tie this game up. So maybe he's in the back. They might have a little place where he could be getting loose. He's wondering why he's not on deck. He's looking out there saying, do they know the pitcher hits? It's the American League. Team playing in a National League city. Manny. Hello.
Well, he might see. I don't know. Got two lefties. Got a righty down there in the bullpen, though. So maybe see if
I think he'd rather
Coach
have
wants to make
up
his
there
move
if
first.
He could.
And there is strikeout number 10.
Well, he's going to use the left-hander.
He's going to bring in Pronk.
Ten strikeouts, getting a wonderful ovation here because up on the big screen, they're putting it up there. But he has been locked in with a lot of different pitches. The fastball up has been an out pitch. The breaking ball to a right-hander down has been an out pitch. The fastball down, completely different than his last outing. The cutter away to a lefty, a cutter away to a righty, and then that breaking ball or fastball there and the one to Sizemore. You know what? This kid went a third of an inning his last outing. 9 hits, 8 runs, 8 earned, and he responds with this. Shows you what he's made of.
And now maybe his toughest challenge of the night. Travis Hafner, who has been relegated to pinch hitting duties with the Indians playing in National League Parks, has not been healthy all season, but when he has been tearing the cover off the ball. He is the tying run right now with 2 down in the 7th inning. The Indians, by the way, are the only American League team to play 9 straight games in National League Parks this year and last year. So Hafner really not getting a chance to do a whole lot. They are on their feet in San Francisco with Bumgarner a pitch away from getting through the 7th inning. I tell you, we are lucky enough to have a lot of toys on this show. I'll take the Ultramo. You guys can have the rest of them. I love that Ultramo. The ultra slow motion camera that gives you such a great look at some of the inside parts of the game. Time now for a look at our game track brought to you by USAA. The Giants are looking to complete the sweep of the Cleveland Indians here this weekend. And thanks to a great performance thus far from Madison Bumgarner, including a career-high 11 strikeouts, they've got a 3-1 lead going to the bottom of the seventh. Here's Brandon Crawford, 1-for-3, singled and scored. Back in the third.
Here he is, Oral against the left-hander, starting really late. Once again, unsure of his swing. He was understood that Carmona was going to throw hard. He started nice and early, had a good rhythm. That approach was one where he was going to hit a ball left field, if anything.
New pitcher into the game for the Cleveland Indians, part of this very deep and talented bullpen we were telling you about, Rafael Perez. Look at the numbers on this guy. A 1.17 ERA this season. This is his 34th appearance.
That's number one in the American League. And the appearance is 33, I think, is around 11th. So quality and quantity.
Here's one of his balls. His hands on top of the ball.
Perez will step off with a 2-1 count on Crawford. Giants are off tomorrow. They will fly to Chicago. They've got a doubleheader against the Cubs on Tuesday. And among the events expected to happen on Tuesday, the return of Barry Zito, who's already on the active roster, but he's going to start one of the games of that doubleheader. Jonathan Sanchez has gone on the DL with biceps tendonitis. And there's strike three called to get Crawford for the first out. And here comes Miguel Tejada, who came on defensively an inning ago for Pablo Sandoval. Buster, what do you hear?
He's got a tight left quad is what the Giants are saying. So obviously they're going to find out more after the game about exactly how serious his injury is.
A few teams have dealt with injuries to the extent that the Giants have this year. Of course, Freddie Sanchez out likely for the season. Buster Posey out for the season. Tejada with a chopper out to second. Two down.
Well, there are a lot of kids out there all who watch the game and listen to a lot of our commentators and our sports guys about being on top of the ball. And see, behind the pitcher is on top of the ball, but when he throws the ball, his hand's really behind the ball. And so many kids are out there trying to put their fingers up on top of the ball when they throw it forward. In order to propel the ball forward with velocity, your fingers have to be behind the ball, not on top of the ball, unless you're throwing a curveball, of course. And so I just hate for people to be confused by what they hear. I know everyone feels like they're getting on top.
Aubrey Huff is the batter. He's 1-for-3, hit an RBI single back in the third. His club leading 39th RBI on the season. The 8 home runs for Huff. That also leads the team. And again, we're pretty much at the midway point of the season right now. That gives you an idea of how things are going for the Giants. Also, amazingly, they've hit only 13 home runs at home the entire season. Make it 14 home runs at home this season. So another high chopper. And the inning is over. We are through seven in San Francisco. 3-1 Giants. Baseball presented by Taco Bell. A 3-1 lead for the Giants over the Indians. ESPN is involved with prostate cancer awareness and research through the V Foundation for Cancer Research. Log on to www.jimmyv.org to learn more. Here's left-hander Jeremy Affeldt to take over for Madison Bumgarner after a sensational seven-inning performance by Bumgarner, giving up a run on five hits and striking out 11. Michael Brantley leads it off for the Indians.
In a two-run game, you're going to see Bruce Bochy really mix and match here for the last six outs of this game. And with Hafner being eliminated, he can now think about closing with his right-hander.
And remember about Brian Wilson being used 4 days in a row. Remind the audience that he will probably not appear here tonight. He even begged into last night's game.
Ramon Ramirez ready if needed in the pen. Slow breaking ball and a beauty. 1-2.
Now, Earl, Manny Acta told us before the game that in these nine games, they are committed to get one at bat for Hafner sometime during a game. Knowing the pitcher or thinking the pitcher might not hit again in the game, he used that situation in the seventh for him to get the at bat.
Brantley knew it. Back to back slow breaking balls by Affeldt to freeze him.
Well, hitters can get hot and pitchers can get hot, and Affeldt over the last 11 games has had a 0.68 ERA. That means he knows what he's doing right now and he's locked in, and those last two breaking balls show you that he has great location and great action on the pitch.
The crowd buzzing over that pitch. Here's Orlando Cabrera, 2-for-3. 2-for-4. Two down. The Giants bullpen has been so good all year, and even better recently. In the month of June, an ERA of 1.74 for the Giants pen collectively. Here's Asdrubal Cabrera, a couple of singles and also an RBI groundout. Right.
Cabrera and Santana are switch hitters. Bruce is going with the left-hander against Cabrera now, and probably against Santana also.
A lot of rotation on that. An extra maybe one on the way to the plate, but that thing was biting.
Jeremy Affeldt making quick work of the Indians in the eighth.
Lead for the Giants over the Indians as they try to sweep the series from Cleveland to the bottom of the eighth, and a Manny Acton goes back to his bullpen for the side-arming right-hander Joe Smith, another one of the many diverse looks that he can bring out of his bullpen, and another guy putting up some seriously good numbers here this season.
We have deception with the arm angle. He's got some great movement. He's got velocity above 90 miles an hour. And he understands what he's doing out there on the mound.
Smith making his 26th appearance of the season. He's got an ERA of 1.13 this year. Didn't get the call there, and he falls behind 2-0. Cody Ross has singled and scored and struck out twice. The big hit of the game is the two-run double by Chris Stewart, the Giants catcher, way back in the second inning. That scored Ross and Hall. But the big performance of the game is the job done by the starting pitcher tonight, Madison Bumgarner. Well, Joe Smith has not gotten the call on a couple of close pitches here this inning. And there's ball four. Well, we mentioned a little bit earlier tonight, the Giants and Indians, of course, have some history. Back in 1954, they met in the World Series. The Indians came in having won 111 games, but were swept. And maybe the moment they know things weren't going to go their way was in Game 1. Arguably the most famous catch in baseball history, made by Willie Mays, almost 480 feet away at the Polo Grounds. Not only did he make the catch, but the runner tagged at second. And on a play like that, I think it was Larry Doby was the runner, could have scored on the fly ball. I mean, think about 480 feet away. That's
80 feet further than the center field fences here in San Francisco. But not only did Willie make the catch, he spun and fired back in. So Dobie was only able to take one base. It was a tie game in the eighth inning at the moment of that play. The game went extra innings, and Dusty Rhodes hit a pinch hit home run to win game one for the Giants. Shearholtz is hit by the pitch.
It was Vic Wirtz who hit that ball, and I interviewed Willie Mays at a Bobby Bregan Foundation dinner once, and I asked him, Willie, what were you thinking about? Did you know you had that ball all the way? And he said, you know, I had a great beat on it, but I knew I had to run over 100 feet, maybe 120 feet to catch it. My only concern was how I was going to throw it back into the infield. I mean, you see how quickly he releases the ball. That was a concern of his. He wanted to get it in so that Dobie wouldn't be able to score on that ball. And here's a thing. Bob Feller never pitched in that World Series. Won 13 games for the Cleveland Indians that year and never got in a game.
Indians again had won 111 games, one of the best regular seasons that any team has ever had in baseball history. And that was a 154-game season. So they only lost 43 times all season. The Giants came in 97-57, and they swept the Indians to win the World Series, which was the last World Series for the Giants franchise until last year. World Series championship for the Giants. World Series victory until last year. And of course, that was back in New York when the New York Giants played at the Polo Grounds.
Dan, did you say that Willie Mays caught that ball at 480 feet?
Well, the center field wall was 483 feet away from home plate, and he was almost.
Where was he playing?
At the wall.
You normally play about
350. Yeah, and he ran 110 feet, 120 feet.
Why was he playing 350 with a man on second?
That's about where he was. That's what
he
says.
Well, he can really charge the ball.
That's what he says.
I mean,
you think he ran
further?
Center
fielder.
It was the ball was in the air about 4 seconds.
Yeah, I think he ran further.
Ground ball to second. One and two for the double play. Runner at third, two down.
I remember timing it one time. The ball was in the air for about 4 seconds, and Willie ran down the first base in 3-4. I figured he had to turn around and run, so he ran 100 plus feet.
Yeah.
If in fact, you know, it was up four plus, you know, 4.2, 4.3.
He was playing
seconds.
Deep. Maybe the wind was blowing out.
350 is pretty deep.
That's real deep.
But it's
that's playing beyond the left field wall if you're the left fielder.
Yeah.
That's deep. I mean, normally outfielder plays 280 to 300 max.
He said he was 350 feet away.
I guess when you've got 480 feet, you got to kind of.
I mean, it's the first time in my life I've ever thought about it. That's a lot of deep.
Inning is over. We are going to the ninth.
by Taco Bell. Think outside the bun. And in part by State Farm. For auto, home, life, and banking, get to a better state. And by Edward Jones. Join the nearly 7 million investors who know FaceTime and ThinkTime make a difference. 3-1, ninth inning. The Giants three outs away from a sweep. And their fifth win in a row overall. They have scored three runs tonight, and they have earned all of them. And they have what, by their standards, is a sizable lead going to the ninth inning, up by two. Compared to the one-run wins that they've had over the Indians each of the last 2 days. Affelt is still in the game after a dominant eighth inning. Carlos Santana leads off the ninth.
And watching these young hitters of Cabrera and Santana one more time, I really like their abilities, but their selection is really leaves a lot to be desired.
Sergio Romo is up in the pen just in case. Again, Brian Wilson has pitched four consecutive games. Bruce Bochy won't use him tonight. Jeremy Affelt is trying to make a case for Sergio Romo not getting into the game tonight.
The deeper in the game you come in as a Giants member of the bullpen, the more facial hair you have. You get to the longest beard when you finally get to Wilson. You get just a little goatee here, a little landing right there. You got the hair going. In the bullpen, you got Romo, it's a little bigger. You get to Wilson, you get full blown. The beard and the hoodie kind of mixed together there. It's really going down, covering almost the orange letters in his chest.
Yeah, they like their hair. Tim has hair. Brian has hair. That's why I thought Jose Reyes would be a perfect fit on this team.
Strike three. Let's take a look now at tonight's AL-NL Showdown update brought to you by State Farm. The American League at one point had a pretty big lead over the National League. The National League has closed the gap here in the last few days, and the Giants trying to bring them a little bit closer. Interleague play will continue through the next week. We will have the Dodgers and the Angels for you 1 week from tonight on Sunday Night Baseball from Anaheim.
Yeah, the Giants are of the theory without offense, it's a long night. Without pitching, it's a long year. They go with pitching first.
Last in the league in offense and first place in their division.
Here's that inside pitch to Grady Sizemore. He has no chance on it. And when you know you have no chance on the inside pitch, you then can throw. If pitch is thrown away, you have to start so early thinking it's inside that you wave at the outside one.
This crowd is on the edge of its seat for every pitch that Affelt is throwing right now.
And no one leaves.
Yeah.
Same state as LA, isn't it?
It is. Different vibe, that's for sure. Boy, we got some kind of a slider tonight.
It's not in a good place right now.
Grady?
Yeah. Well, I'm not going to hit the breaking ball. I can't hit the inside fastball. Here comes the inside fastball. Didn't even get in.
Two down. They have sold out every single home game this season. As the love affair between the team and the town continues on the heels of the World Series championship a year ago. They're looking for their fifth win in a row. They are finding a way somehow to win all of these close, low-scoring games. Shelly Duncan, the batter.
And you can see Chris Stewart froze and double pumped a little bit, expecting that pitch to be called a strike. But it's 2-0.
And then he just looks over his shoulder to Jerry Lane and says, oh, a little inside. Jerry nodded yes. Okay, we're on the same page. Stay with me, big guy.
There have been plenty of strikes thrown tonight by Giant pitchers. Madison Bumgarner threw 70% strikes. Before this last hitter got to 2-1, Jeremy Outfeld was throwing 72% strikes.
And of the last 15 outs recorded by Giants pitchers, 12 of them have been strikeouts. Bumgarner, Outfeld combining for a great night. 3-1. The tying run is in the on deck circle right now with two down here in the ninth inning. The right-hander Romo is ready if needed. Right-hand hitting Lou Marson is in the on deck circle. There are some left-handed bats available on the bench for the Indians. Full count.
But one you won't see is Travis Hafner, who batted against a left-handed pitcher in the seventh, thinking that this situation wouldn't occur where he could maybe hit as a tying run against a right-hander tonight.
The Giants win again. Jeremy Affeld pitches two innings, faces six batters, and strikes out five of them. On the heels of an 11 strikeout performance by Madison Bumgarner, and the Giants sweep the Indians with a 3-1 win here on Sunday night to move a game and a half ahead of the Arizona Diamondbacks atop the National League West Division. Morrill, you had to be impressed with the Giants pitching tonight.
They had an outstanding breaking ball, Jeremy did, but at times he threw a power split. This is 90 miles an hour. Some of these were 91. He loved it.
Get an off day tomorrow and get ready for a doubleheader.
The Giants score only 8 runs in the 3-game series, and they sweep it because they held the Indians to only 4 runs in 3 games here in San Francisco. Tonight, Chevrolet player of the game is the starting pitcher and the winner for the Giants, Madison Bumgarner, who goes 7 innings, gives up just a run on 5 hits, walks one, and he strikes out a career-high 11 for the win, his 4th win of the season. Bumgarner is our Chevrolet player of the game. 1 week from tonight, we invite you to join us from Anaheim. It'll be the Dodgers and the Angels on Sunday Night Baseball next week. The Giants win tonight 3-1, and they sweep it. Coming up next here on ESPN, stay tuned for SportsCenter. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Oral Hershiser, Bobby.